There were a couple of odd people in Europe who offered me pages from the letters, which I thought was bizarre. And you'd sort of get a page which began nowhere and would sort of have a couple of pregnant details and go nowhere. But they weren't much use anyway. I'd have liked to have seen what he wrote to Thea Astley, but she declined. Other than that, really it was people's generosity that surprised and pleased me most.
When you were collating these letters, was there any equivocation in your own mind as to the ownership of it?
One of the difficult things was that I knew that I wanted to fashion the book. I wanted to make it a narrative. I wanted Patrick to be telling his story without repetition. I wanted to cut out the bits that were not much interest anymore. And it would be my compilation, my cut of the letters. And that did give me pause because, and I don't say this with any pride, but with some fear, I'm the only person ever to have edited Patrick White. He never allowed it in his lifetime. He never allowed anybody to touch his writing. It had to be done for the letters, I think, if it was to be a book that was going to be read. I mean, it would be so easy to do the three-volume set of the collected letters of Patrick White, which no one in their right minds would ever read. I wanted it to be read. So in that sense, it had to become my idea of what this should be. And that's a very audacious thing, very audacious.
In the selection of the letters, is it possible we've missed the humour of the man somewhere?
I don't find that. I find, in fact, for the most part, that they are surprisingly funny and able to...
Well, they're frank, but I was looking for a sort of worked out wit, if you like.
The wit just sparks away. Sometimes there are deliberately very funny stories, like the mating of the dogs in the dog parlour, when suddenly the television started to sing, "Sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, you're rocking the boat," at which the dog did, and that was the end of the mating session. There are set pieces like that, and great set pieces of the travel writing. The letters, I think, are some of the most exquisite travel writing that survive in Australian writing. I find them very funny.
And his letters are very frank. I mean, the frankness was clear. Back when he was a tiny boy in 1919, writing to the fairies. "Dear fairies, would you give me a book? I don't mind what kind it is. Can I have it on my birthday? It's on the 28th of May. I hope you'll have a nice dance tonight. I expose you have tea on the toadstools at night," and so on, "and would make the influenza better. I wish you would, with love from Paddy." It's a very precocious letter, actually, isn't it?
It's a beautiful letter. It's precocious, but it's also sceptical. "I suppose you have tea on the toadstools at night. Come on, let's have an explanation of this." But the other thing about it, of course, is that it mentions the drought, the great drought after the First World War and the great influenza epidemic. And it showed that this kid, although he's been brought up in Sydney, his imagination was absolutely locked into what was happening out in the bush because they were suffering drought. And it's a beautiful little letter because it just goes from the fairies to an epidemic to the drought, and that little questioning mind saying, "What are you really up to? Come on, prove yourselves."
And 70 years later, writing to Geoffrey Dutton, a lifelong friend, "I'm sorry, but I've had enough of Duttonry, and ask you not to ring me when you fly from capital to capital, for what I can't see as any good reason. And please, let there be no correspondence. As you know, I don't keep letters, but this one will be an exception to show the curious why our relationship ended." Well, it seems a very sudden, a very brutal letter.
I don't think so. I think in the full correspondence with Dutton in the book that you can see that the warnings come early, the warnings that are unheeded, the rebukes that are also unheeded, and the advice, which might seem impertinent, was actually good advice. He was saying to Geoff Dutton, "Concentrate, stop trying to do so much." I mean, Dutton was in at the beginning of just about everything that we understand about modern literary institutions in this country, of magazines and committees and organizations. He was flying everywhere, and he was writing very quickly. Patrick was disappointed with the writing. And of course, as a grazier's child, Patrick was terribly upset to see them selling paddock by paddock the great property Anlaby outside Adelaide, which was the Duttons' inheritance. The break was not, I think, sudden, though when it came, it was very dramatic.
And I take it there was clear permission given by Patrick White for you to go ahead and put the letters together.
It came in two stages. First, the permission to actually collect them to use for the biography, and it was the great decisive moment in my relationship with White when I finally plucked up the courage to ask him, because it meant getting from him an agreement to change his orders to the world, no longer to destroy, but in fact to provide them to me. And he did do that, and that was the great moment. Everything followed from that. And towards the end of my time writing the biography, when I realized that there was this mass of wonderful material which would never and should never be put into the biography, otherwise the thing would just drown, I warned him that I was going to ask to do a book of letters. And he didn't respond at the time, and I waited until we had gone right through the process, the agonizing process of me sitting there while he read the whole biography to himself over 9 days. And when it was finished, and he said this mute little, "Well, thank you," we had a little talk, and in that talk I said, "Well, now I want to do the letters." And he said, "Oh yes, yes, you must do the letters, but not too quickly. You've got to give the biography its commercial life." He was a pro. He was really a pro.
And David, I think the only time you are actually mentioned in the letters is here in a letter to Elizabeth Falkenberg. David Marr is still writing away at the biography. I'm afraid he'll overdo it and a lot will have to be ripped out. Biographers become unfortunately obsessed by the subject. And
all biographies
are
too long.
So were you obsessed?
Well, I suppose I was for a while. I suppose I couldn't have finished it without being obsessed by the need to finish it. It's curious now. It's the first time for 10 years that I haven't had a book about Patrick White on the desk, on my conscience. Rather different. The world looks different.
This book may encourage other Australians, of course, to write letters, to feel they have a stake in immortality.
They may. I think letter writing is something that is drummed in very early, very early. And for a little boy like Patrick White, who was away at boarding school, who was made to write letters first by his mother, then made to write letters by his school teachers, it was a habit for life. I don't think I'm a better letter writer for having spent the last 10 years, as one of my friends says, reading other people's mail. I think maybe I try a little harder now. But biographers, of course, master only one thing. That's the begging letter. Please help me. Please give me more. Please explain to me what you've already given to me. And then please give me more. Those letters I've been writing for 10 years.
And David, what do you think is the principal characteristic of these letters? I mean, how would you sum them up?
Well, in the end, I made my claim for his letters in a little note at the back. I think Patrick White's letters are the work of a master of English prose. His 70 years correspondence from childhood in the First World War until his death in 1990 is earthy, shrewd, camp, savage, dramatic, very funny and free. White wrote novels to impress a hostile world, but most of his correspondence was written to amuse, inform, and at times upbraid his friends. He was an old man before he wrote fiction as easy and direct as the best of his letters.
David Marr, thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks.
It's a classic culture conflict, the art establishment versus the radical fringe.
They'd probably spit on me if they could, but in the long run it's not going to matter, you know, because they're just art bureaucrats, they're frustrated artists, you know, and the cream always rises to the surface anyway.
Well, I don't think anybody's condemning them or spitting on them or anything else, to be perfectly honest.
It started when the Hawke government donated the old gunnery building at Woolloomooloo to the state for use as a visual arts centre. It seemed ideal for studios, a gallery and offices. But there's a problem. The gunnery is already full of artists. 20 or so squatters who've been living here for 5 years. And when the state government served eviction orders on them, the paint started flying.
Well, I think the bureaucrats in this town have got an abundance of space, even too much space, you know. They take too much control, whereas artists have no space at all. This is one of the few places, you know.
For years, the art world has been crying out for public support, for public funding. Now we've got it, for studio space, for exhibition space, and we are actually squabbling. A group of squatters, come artists, are actually placing the project in jeopardy. It is very difficult to believe.
The eviction has set off the perennial question, what is art, what is an artist, and most of all, which artist should get the goodies from the government?
The ferment of a place like that will always produce good things.
So something like a fringe squatter sort of community is necessary for
it's
the production?
Absolutely essential for any society to have a radical irritant keeping the society honest and provoking the society.
What's happened there has been terrific. It's a lot of energy. As you say, it is subcultural, and that's ephemeral, you know. Kids get together, they find a space, they do things, but it can't, I don't think, expect to become a government institution. And if it did become that, I think it would die. I mean, it would lose its ephemeral nature, it would lose its alternativeness, you know.
There is a 19th century sort of bohemian notion of the artist living on the edge, but that doesn't guarantee that the art that the person makes is necessarily any more progressive or adventurous or anything else. I mean, anyone can call themselves an artist. It's really what you do and what your commitment is that stands the test.
They don't really have any idea of what goes on here because they never bothered to find out. They call us dirty squatters or whatever names they want to call us, but the thing is that they can't see beyond their blinkers, you know, because they expect to come down and see a building which has got, you know, lots of gyprock walls and carpets and air conditioning or whatever, and I think that's what, you know, they see the environment, they don't see what's going on inside of it.
Well, it's certainly not air-conditioned comfort. Here the smell of stale coffee and sweat mixes with ageing paint, and strange sounds float up from the basement. It's not an easy existence, but then no artist's, it seems, is.
I mean, they can't just dump them out on the street.
Alison Clouston, who's now exhibiting at the Ray Hughes Gallery, says she built her career on squatter roots.
It was important for me. Like, maybe I wouldn't be here today doing this exhibition if I hadn't had that really amazing opportunity to get, you know, to totally concentrate on the work.
And even some of those more established in the art world will admit to a bohemian past.
And have you ever lived in a squat yourself?
To tell the truth, in London, I think 1962, I lived in a squat just off Sloane Square in London and did murals all over the basement. It probably looks a bit like that does.
Whether the gunnery squatters would blossom into Picassos given a few more years, we'll probably never know. While they haven't given up the fight, the squatters have seen the writing on the wall. The End of the World is the title for what will probably be their last exhibition.
bigger than this, Brian.
Yes, but you've got to make it work for telly. Vision.
And then you'll run it?
If you give me vision, I'll run it every night for a week.
Okay.